Welcome, and thank you for joining us for this lecture series on lessons not learned from the Holocaust. My name is Mika Ahuvia, and I'm the Marsha and Jay Glazer Endowed Chair in Jewish Studies here at the Stroum Center for Jewish Studies in the Henry M. Jackson School of International Studies at the University of Washington. The University of Washington acknowledges the Coast Salish people of this land, the land which touches the shared waters of all tribes and bands within the Suquamish, Tulalip, and Muckleshoot nations. My family and I are grateful to live and work as guests on these lands. This land acknowledgement is but one small gesture in the ongoing process of working towards repairing and sustaining relations with Coast Salish lands, waters, peoples, and their other than human kin. As curriculum chair for Jewish studies, I'll be facilitating this series of events, which is also a 2-credit course here at the University of Washington. This course and lecture series came about in part because students asked for it and because a growing number of us realized there was a need for it. A large number of faculty at the University of Washington teach Holocaust studies related courses or have teaching or research that intersects with Holocaust studies, but were unaware of each other's research and teaching. Students too, though interested in Holocaust studies in high numbers, are not aware of the array of Holocaust courses available in a variety of departments or related classes that may not have Holocaust in the title, but incorporate material about the Holocaust. So to that end, the Stroum Center for Jewish Studies here at UW organized this course where a variety of faculty members can share their disciplinary perspectives on the Holocaust and its significance. I especially want to thank Naomi Sokolov, Susan Glenn, Devin Narr, James Felak, Richard Block, Nicholas Barr, and Lori Marhofer. We are here because of their vision and dedication. Behind the scenes of programming are also dedicated professionals like Dr. Sarah Zadis-Rosen, Kara Schoonemaker, Emily Thompson, Lauren Kurland, and Rosa Lasley. My gratitude to them for their dedication in transitioning this lecture series online so seamlessly. Finally, this lecture series was made possible by the support and the partnership of Stephen Burrell. It was thanks to his intellectual curiosity and commitment to advancing the field of Holocaust education at the University of Washington that made him the perfect partner for this project. At the beginning of this pandemic, it was Stephen who put his faith in the Stroum Center faculty and staff by giving us the flexibility and trusting us to move this course and event online. So thank you, Stephen, for your generosity. I also want to thank all of you who spontaneously donated to show support for this series. We want to make thoughtful and critical education programming free and accessible to all, and your donations help make that a reality. So in order to keep the focus on the presentation, attendees in this Zoom webinar do not have video and microphone enabled. I welcome you to submit questions via the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. You will also find a closed caption button that you can use to switch to captions on and off for this presentation. We are recording, and video will be posted on the Stroum Center YouTube channel in the next 1 to 2 days. Everyone who registered will receive an email with the link. So my lecture today is going to be about 45 minutes, then we'll take a 15-minute break, and starting at 5 p.m., we'll take your questions in the Q&A box. I will always start with a question from students in the course, but I also look forward to your questions. And apologies in advance if I run out of time to answer your question. Okay, let's get going. The title of this lecture is The History of Jewish Difference and Anti-Judaism as Ideology. Unlike the rest of the contributors to this lecture series, my expertise is in antiquity, in ancient religious texts, primarily the foundations of classical Judaism in the Greco-Roman world. So I turned to ancient history to help make sense of contemporary issues. For me, going back 2,000 years in time gives me just enough perspective to understand how we arrived in the 20th century. And I hope to show you how going back to the origins of Jewish difference might help us understand the function of anti-Judaism as a powerful ideology that has had cultural resonance for almost 2 millennia. So I conceived of this lecture as responding to 3 interrelated problems. First, many students study the Holocaust without ever studying Jews, right? So that means they study anti-Judaism without ever studying what it is that made the Jewish people resilient in the face of anti-Judaism. A related problem is that because Americans have been sort of trained in both sides' approach to problems and events, students often ask professors in Holocaust studies classes, but what's the other side of the story? In other words, they're asking, but what's the Nazi version of events? Don't we have to hear the Nazi version of events to understand how this happened? I think this ties into a larger problem of students are just people kind of seeking easy answers and knowledge that lets them sleep at night, right? I think that true wisdom kind of wakes you up and makes you want to study more and figure out how to do things. But I think many students are just, they just want the right answer. They just want to check off a box. They just want to go to sleep. And maybe the idea of identifying with a victim is just too painful, right? Maybe it's compassion fatigue. But maybe it's also that we just haven't been schooled in the mechanics of dehumanization, right? How it is that hatred and prejudice go from being personal and individual to being culture-wide and useful to, you know, some aspect of the elite. These are really hard problems. It's not fun to study dehumanization, but I think it's more important than ever that we figure out what it looks like and how it works in practice. So what I hope to do in this lecture is to convey some basic facts about Jews, Jewish history, and Judaism. I'm basically gonna try to summarize all of Intro to Judaism in 15 minutes. I'm gonna investigate two cases of anti-Judaism with you that you probably haven't heard of, the genocide of Jews in Alexandria in 115 to 117 CE, kind of a pre-religious case study, I would argue, and Christian anti-Judaism in the Byzantine period, which has repercussions through the medieval period. Now, obviously, I can't be thorough in 35 minutes. Students, you're not going to learn everything you need to know about Judaism in 15 minutes, but I hope to just give you kind of a sense of what there is to learn and maybe, you know, show you what how you could go deeper if you chose to, either through other classes, through informal programming, or maybe through one of the books I suggest. I am going to try to persuade you that anti-Judaism has very little to do with Jews per se, and much more to do with the role that Jews fulfill in the cultural imagination of people within deeply unequal and unstable societies. So let's get into it. Who is Jewish? What is Jewish? Some basic facts about Jews, Jewish history, and Judaism. I like starting classes with this graph, which shows kind of the distribution of religious groups in the world. You can see 30% of the global population identifies as Christian, 24% as Muslim, and just a very, very tiny percentage as Jewish. If we look at this in terms of numbers, we have 2,300 million Christians worldwide, 1,800 million Muslims, and 14 million Jews, right? So an order of magnitude fewer Jews. If we look at Jews in the United States, we can see that there are 5.7 million Jews or so. That translates into about every kind of 2 in 100 Americans. And 1 in 6 of American Jews has converted to Judaism, by the way, right? So note that 71% of Americans identify as Christian, only 23% identify as unaffiliated, right? Sometimes they're called the nons, the non-religious. These are mostly millennials and Generation Z, okay? So that means that most Americans still identify, right, through a religious identification. Okay, so the origins of the Jewish people take us back to the ancient Middle East, to the crossroads, of ancient empires, particularly the ancient Egyptian Empire, the ancient Babylonian Empire, and the ancient Assyrian Empire. So these are going to come up as I tell you about Jewish history. Now, I should mention that asking or answering the question of what is the origins of the Jewish people is always a politically fraught one. It's hard to bracket the political aspects of this question. And I think the person who's done a really good job discussing this and laying out this problem is Stephen Weitzman, The Origins of the Jews, The Quest for Roots in a Rootless Age. So I'm going to kind of set aside the political dimension of this problem to kind of focus on where Jews originated. So generally, when I start talking about the ancient Jews, I actually prefer to use the term Israelites. And that's because in their own texts, Jews refer to themselves as Israelites. We don't see the Jews using the self-identification Jews until after 500 BCE. So when I'm talking about the period of like 1000 BCE, I'm generally going to talk about Israelites. A few times you do see the term Hebrews as well. It's not nearly as common as Israelites, but it does show up in some archaeological evidence. So obviously the ancient Israelites spoke Hebrew. The word Hebrew seems to actually relate to the word of a cross, ever, right? So it has some sense of movement. So what we can say about the ancient Israelites is that they were united by a sense of shared ancestry, myth, ritual, and history. And they originated basically, you know, roughly in the territory of modern Israel, what we call the ancient Levant or ancient Canaan, right? That's who the ancient Israelite was. So a little bit more about them. The ancient Israelites believed that they were descendants of three people, of Abraham, his son Isaac, and grandson Jacob. Jacob himself is renamed Israel, right? So that gives you a sense of like they had some sort of shared memory of a name change. And they tended to refer to themselves as the sons of Israel or the daughters of Israel. Okay, so if you look in the Hebrew Bible and the Torah, right, the text that is most sacred to the Jews, right, you will see this self-identification, the sons or daughters of Israel, the most. The myth that really kind of binds the ancient Israelites together and binds them to their God is the Exodus narrative, right? This is the second book of the Hebrew Bible, of the Torah. It's a story about liberation from enslavement in ancient Egypt. All right, so this is the foundational story of the Israelites and their God, right? So the quick version of the story is ancient Canaan was in a period of droughts, right? The Israelites go down into Egypt for food. They're a minority there. They're enslaved. And God kind of intervenes in history, right? There's all these miraculous plagues. And with the help of Moses, he liberates them. They have this wilderness journey with God. And when they get to Mount Sinai, they are recipients. They receive this divine instruction, divine revelation, divine teachings. And then they return to the promised land. Now, students often ask me, but did this really happen? And as I tell them, it doesn't really matter whether it happened or not. The thing is, this story was powerful enough to bind people together. Enough people in 1000 BCE had experienced ancient Egypt as an oppressor, as an enslaver, that when they were told a story about liberation from enslavement, like they felt personally invested in it. And the way I like to explain this to students is, okay, many of us watching this lecture, right, probably consider ourselves American. Now, did all of us experience the events of 1776, right? Are all of us like descended from those people that, you know, declared independence from England? Like, no. But if we feel like that story is ours, if we feel like the story of the Constitution speaks to us in some way, then that creates a sense of shared identity. So the story of the Exodus is a story that creates a sense of shared history and identity. Okay, whether it happened is sort of irrelevant. Now, right, part of that story was a revelation of a sacred text. Now in Hebrew, this is known as the Torah. It literally means in Hebrew, instruction or teaching, right? Distinctive teachings of Torah is the title there. But in Greek, this was translated as nomos or law. So in the Christian Bible, when you see references to the law, They're often referring to Hebrew Torah. Now, when I share the Torah with students, you know, especially the legal collections in the Torah, you know, I ask them what their impressions are, and, you know, and students were like, well, I mean, most of these laws seem pretty typical of functioning society, right? Don't murder, don't steal, things like that. But what did stand out to ancient peoples when they encountered Hebrew or Jewish law is these three particular aspects. Male infant circumcision, which happens on the eighth day, the observance of the Sabbath as a day of rest, right, of no work, and the dietary restrictions, particularly abstaining from pork and not mixing like meat and dairy. Now, pork even today is the most popularly consumed meat in the world, right? So that means that abstaining from pork kind of set the Jews apart. Okay, so these were some of the distinctive teachings that ancient Greeks and Romans, for example, noticed about the Jews and thought were a little strange. So those are some distinctive teachings. Now, I very briefly want to talk about some shared history or memory of the golden age, right? So the golden age of ancient Israel is when there was a King David, right? When this is kind of the memory of the expansive, right, territory of ancient Israel. King David is associated with foundation of the city of Jerusalem, kind of in the center. Ancient Israelite society was supposedly, or, you know, divided between 12 tribes, 10 of them in the north, and 2 of them in the south. In 722 BCE, the 10 tribes of northern Israel are conquered by the ancient Assyrian Empire. Right, here's a stele of theirs celebrating the Assyrian conquest of the tribes. You can see them kind of being led out there. And so after 722 BCE, only the kind of tribes of the south, the tiny kingdom of Judea, continue. So David and Solomon are kind of remembered as kind of the leaders of this golden age, right? Solomon's associated with the first great temple, but it's a very, very short-lived golden age, right? It's like 2 generations, but it might come up in importance later. So I just mentioned that now. And right, again, right? The story of the ancient Israelites is a story about a tiny people amidst all these other superpowers. Most of the books of the Hebrew Bible are actually about kind of the survival of the Jews and how they're trying to maintain their identity and their relationship with God amidst this polytheistic world where there are many other competing gods and more successful peoples. Now, in the 6th century BCE, the ancient Israelites endure another catastrophe, right? One that could have ended Jewish history. This is when the Empire of Babylonia conquers the tiny kingdom of Judea. Now, this really could have been the end of Jewish history, because when the Babylonians conquered ancient people, they destroyed everything, took everything, but they also particularly wanted to exile the people most responsible for a culture. So they exiled the elite, but also all the scribes, all of the musicians, anybody that kind of kept a memory for the people. So why didn't this kind of spell the end of Jewish history? 2 reasons. The Israelites believed that God worked through history, even through catastrophes and misfortunes. So the prophet Jeremiah, very important biblical prophet, had a lot of criticism of his fellow Israelites for like not being good enough monotheists, for not trusting in God fully. But he also promises them, look, you're being punished right now, but God's going to call you back in 70 years. Okay, he's going to take care of you. So again, it's like this kind of familial relationship with God where, you know, like, okay, like you misbehave, God punishes you, but he's still there for you. And even when it looks like the Babylonians are destroying, right, your temple and everything, it doesn't mean that the Babylonian gods have won. It means that our God is actually in charge and working through the Babylonians to teach you something. So this is kind of, it's a very powerful explanation for why bad things happen, and it seems to have persuaded Jews for the most part. So the Jews are exiled to Babylonia. Some Jews do flee into Egypt. In some ways, I like to think of this as the beginning of the Jewish diaspora, right? Diaspora is from the word dispersion. And as we'll see, right, this is not the end of the Jewish story, because the days of the Babylonian Empire are numbered. And the next great empire that arises is the Persian Empire. And just like Jeremiah predicted about 70 years later, the Persian Empire pursues a very different policy in how it treats its people. The Persian Empire believes in really being multicultural. They believe that the best way to ensure peace throughout the empire is to restore people to their homelands and help them live according to their ancestral laws, even giving them money to rebuild their temples. So the Persian Emperor Cyrus, the only non-Jew called the Messiah in the Hebrew Bible, allows the Israelites to go back to the province of Judea. Okay, and this is when we start seeing Jews call themselves Judean, right, as opposed to just Israelites. They're restored to the province of Judea, right? They recognize Cyrus as the King of Kings, but they also continue to live out according to their ancestral laws. This is around 515 BCE, is where we see the Torah written down as a sacred text. For the first time, probably. It was probably an oral, right, tradition before. Now it's written down. Okay. So what unites the Jews at this point, around 500 BCE, right? They have allegiance to one God. They have these legendary ancestors. They have the foundational myth of Exodus. They have these distinctive rituals of the Sabbath. All that and more you can find in the Torah. And they have this sense that God is working through history. So the next really important empire to impact the Jews and Jewish history is the empire of Alexander the Great, right? Comes out of Greece, right, in 334 BCE, right? Goes on to just, you know, conquer this amazing amount of territory. And it's important for us to linger on Alexander the Great because he really accelerates Jewish habitation in other locales, right? So Jews end up joining Alexander the Great's armies, serving in his armies, right, and traveling with him elsewhere. So if you look at this map I have on the screen, you see everywhere there's an A, right? Here's an A, here's an A, a bunch of A's over here. Those are all cities named Alexandria. The most famous ancient Alexandria is probably this one in Egypt, right? So many Jews end up traveling, right, as mercenaries in Alexander's army and end up relocating to Egypt, right, where the famous Library of Alexandria was located. Now, everywhere that Alexander conquered and formed, and you know, in Alexandria, he would give his own soldiers kind of land grants and allow them to sort of settle down after they retired. So by the first century CE, right, so four centuries later, inhabitants of Alexandria, right, Jewish inhabitants of Alexandria were very much like a part of the Hellenistic Empire. Right, so if we turn to Philo of Alexandria, famous Jewish philosopher of the first century, when he describes who the Jews are in the first century, he says, "For so populous are the Jews that no one country can contain them, and therefore they dwell in many of the most prosperous countries in Europe and Asia, both in the islands and on the mainland. And while they hold the holy city, where stands the sacred temple of the Most High God, to be their mother city," right, he's obviously referring to Jerusalem here, "yet those which are theirs by inheritance from their fathers, grandfathers, and ancestors even farther back, are in each case accounted by them to be their fatherland, in which they were born and reared, while to some of them they have come at the very time of their foundation as colonists, as a favor to the founders." Now, as Cynthia Baker points out in her analysis of this text, what Philo seems to be saying is that Jews have this hybrid identity, right? They have this, like, Jerusalem is their mother kind of city, their metropolis on the one hand, but their fatherlands are everywhere. Right? Because going back, like, just even four centuries, they already have been traveling with Alexander and forming, right, residencies in other parts of the world. right? So Jews already in the first century CE seem to be identifying as like Jewish and Alexandrian, Jewish and Roman, Jewish and Asian, Jewish and Syrian, Jewish and Macedonian, right? And all this, right? There's already a hybrid identity for Jews going back 2,000 years. Right, and we can actually see an echo of this in other texts, for instance, texts that we find in the New Testament. So in Acts of the Apostles, right, the author, which we associate with that, Luke, says that it happened that there were staying in Jerusalem Jews, pious men from every nation. What does it mean to say that they were Jews from every nation? Right, it seems to recognize that there are already Jews living all over the world who identify as Jews and also as something else. Okay, so to sum this up, who are the Jews? They may have started out, right, as Israelite inhabitants of Canaan. They spread throughout the Mediterranean and into Asia. They're united by allegiance to one God, a sense of shared ancestry, history, and distinctive practices. All of these details can be found in their sacred texts of the Torah and the rest of the Hebrew Bible. In this way, we can see that Judaism was in part an ethnicity, in part religion, and in part culture. Now, this is where students sometimes object. Wait a second, Professor Ahuvia, isn't Judaism just a religion? Well, students, Judaism is actually all of those things, and this is actually the subject of a lot of debate. The entire field of modern Jewish thought is about trying to understand how Judaism can be an ethnicity, a religion, or a culture. And in fact, if you ask Americans, right, to identify as Jewish, right? Some identify as Jewish by religion. Some identify as Jewish by no religion. So you can play with this calculator online on Pew. You can study this subject with our very own Professor Noam Pianko, the chair of Jewish studies. You can also read about how Judaism became a religion in this lovely book by Lior Butnitsky. But to make a really complex matter short, Judaism is all of those things and transcends those categories. But let's end with a quick little story. Right, if I had to summarize Judaism in one sentence, how would I do it? Luckily, it's been done for me by two ancient sages. Right, so if you've heard of Hillel, right, the Jewish campus center, that's named after an ancient Jewish sage, Hillel, who lived in the first century CE. And when he was asked to summarize the entire Torah, right, all of Judaism in on one foot, you know, how would you do that? He said, look, basically, it all comes down to what is hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor. That's the entire Torah. The rest is commentary, right? Go study. Interestingly, Jesus, right, associated with the religion of Christianity, was also asked, right, to kind of summarize the most important parts of Judaism, right? What's the most important commandment, he was asked. Jesus actually says two things. He has two answers. His first answer is that the most important part of the Torah is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Jews might recognize this as the what's called the Shema prayer, which is found in the Torah. And the second thing he said was the most important part about Judaism is you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There's no other commandment greater than these. All right, so you might recognize this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, as being quite similar as what's hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor. Right, so we're going to come back to the relationship of Judaism and Christianity very soon, but already I want to kind of alert you to this kind of common ground. Okay, so let's leave off part one. I hope you have some kind of sense of who the Jews are. And now let's talk about anti-Judaism as ideology. And I've kind of placed a couple books there that were helpful to me as I was considering these issues. Okay. So what does Jew mean? As Cynthia Baker points out in her study of the word Jew has served as a cipher for materialism and intellectualism, socialism and capitalism, worldly cosmopolitanism and clannish parochialism, eternal chosenness and unending curse. Okay, so already I hope you're saying, wait a second, there's a lot of contradictions in this sentence, right? So as we get into the study of anti-Judaism, okay, notice that we're entering the realm of contradictions. And interestingly, you know, all of these kind of contradictory connotations don't just exist for, you know, people in Europe and America, but if, you know, we go to China, for example, and look at how Jew is defined there, we see that anything which is not Chinese is sometimes called Jewish. Anything which is too Chinese is also Jewish. Anything which the Chinese aspire to is Jewish. At the same time, anything which the Chinese despise is Jewish. Okay, so even in places where there hasn't been a significant population of Jews, Jews come to stand for these sort of contradictions. So I've just talked to you, right, about what ancient Jews were up to, right? But how were they perceived by others? How was this list perceived by other peoples? So when we find ancient Greeks and Romans talking about Jews, they'll often comment on the fact that it's very strange that Jews reject the other gods and are so focused on allegiance to one god. And what about the Exodus story? Well, what do you think the ancient Egyptians think about the Exodus story, right? I mentioned that the ancient Egyptians were a superpower, right? They were also associated with great wisdom. Do you think they liked that there was this like minority group of people talking about them being liberated from Egyptian enslavement and their god punishing the Egyptians, right? They probably did not go over well. And how did ancient Greeks and Romans kind of respond to the Torah? Well, they didn't think so highly of it, right? They thought that the Sabbath was a sign of like laziness, right? They often criticized Jews as lazy. They thought that circumcision was kind of barbaric, and they thought that their dietary laws were really ridiculous and antisocial. So how did this manifest in life? So again, let's go to our first case study of Jews in Hellenistic Egypt, right? So I mentioned that Jews became soldiers in Alexander's armies. They formed their own civic communities in ancient Egypt. Like Greek soldiers, they obtained land grants in exchange for service. They formed their own communities. They constructed synagogues, right? Some of our oldest archaeological evidence for Jews comes from ancient Egypt. And of course, the translation of the Torah into ancient Greek also happened in ancient Egypt, right? This is what becomes the Christian Old Testament, right? Is this translation of the Torah into Greek. So there is tension between the Hellenistic or Greek members of the elite and the Jewish community. And it's particularly among these kind of Hellenized immigrants, Greek immigrants to Egypt, that we first find these retellings of the Exodus story that paint Jews as undesirable intruders who actually left Egypt because they had a plague and they were sick and they were expelled, right? So it's interesting that, you know, I'm sure like the native Egyptians might have also disliked, you know, both the Greek immigrants and the Jewish immigrants, but it's among the Greek population in Egypt that we find kind of the earliest anti-Jewish writings, right, where they accuse Jews of separatism and unsociability. Now, things really get much worse when Rome conquers Egypt in 30 BCE. Generally, Romans saw the inhabitants of their conquered territories as either like citizens or non-citizens. There wasn't really like a space for like these kind of middle Greek immigrants, right, who seemed to think that they deserved higher status than the local population. According to the Jewish historian Josephus, the total population of Roman Egypt was 8 million, right? So 6.5 million native Egyptians, 1.5 million Greek immigrants, and 300,000 Jews, over half of which lived in Alexandria. So when the Romans took over ancient Egypt, they restructured society. And originally they just wanted to like deprive all the Greek immigrants of their privileges. And the Greeks really protested this. They didn't want to lose their privileges. These privileges, by the way, were things like access to education, the ability to participate in civic politics, in athletic competitions. They wanted to be exempt from certain taxes. So the compromise that the Romans came up with was that the Greeks could maintain some of these privileges, but some Jews could too, right? If the Jews that lived in the city of Alexandria itself, right, those urban residents could maintain some privileges, but anybody who lived in rural territory was reclassified as a foreigner and lost all those privileges. Now, the Alexandrian Greeks, interestingly, reacted by asserting that, right, this wasn't fair. Actually, all the Jews were aliens. All of them were foreigners. This is where we really see an increase in anti-Jewish rhetoric, right? They accuse Jews of being antisocial. They have weird laws, or they, in hyperbole, say actually they're lawless. you know, they don't eat pork. It's really weird. Actually, maybe they're secretly cannibals, like eating Greek and secret rituals every year. They're misanthropic. They hate God. Like, how can you give them privileges and take away privileges from us? So what we see is these Greeks are suffering, right, from a new kind of Roman ruler being present on the scene, but they really target all of their anger at the Jews, who until that point in time had enjoyed the same privileges as they had. So what David Nierenberg, I think, does really well in his chapter on this, in his book, Anti-Judaism, is he explains that exclusion really was vital. It was important to the ancient Greeks' sense of themselves. The ancient Greeks saw themselves as this like sovereign people with this imperial history, and exclusion was really important to their sense of self, right? For the Greeks, sharing privileges meant that their identity was under attack. Now, what's interesting is that the real threat here was obviously Roman imperialism, right? The Romans had just taken over the Greeks. The Romans were taking away their privileges. But the Greeks really focus on the Jews, and they really criticize Romans through the Jews. Sometimes they even accuse Roman senators of being Jewish, right? There were no Jewish Roman senators. But it's really interesting how we see this language and rhetoric of anti-Judaism develop at exactly this time. And of course, the advantage of, right, blaming the Jews or directing anger at the Jews is that you also get kind of the local Egyptian population that might be resentful of intruders to join up with you. So what happens to the Jewish community in Rome? Throughout the first century, there are spontaneous attacks, mobs, riots in the Jewish quarter of Alexandria. In 66 CE, we have a report that 50,000 Jews were slaughtered. But in 115 CE, matters got much worse. And, you know, we only have kind of the writings of the victors preserved. You know, of course, they blame the Jews for rebelling, but it's also possible that, you know, they were simply attacked. And what we can tell from kind of the evidence is that it seems like the entire population of Egypt, both within Alexandria and in the countryside, was just annihilated. And we can tell from surviving tax records, you know, from ancient Egypt, that the Roman treasury confiscated Jewish property and land. For at least a century after this genocide, Egyptians were actually celebrating a day of victory against the Jews. So the anti-Jewish rhetoric was very powerful. And even after the Jews were kind of eliminated from Egypt, it remains kind of in the air and remains available for later Greek and Roman writers to use. And that's what we see. So what are the lessons for us? Again, notice who was in charge, right? Notice what the position of the Jews was in society, right? They were in this weird kind of precarious position. Notice who attacked and who benefited. And notice that, like, what happened with the Jews, you could say, had, like, very loosely, like, in all, like, see some resemblance maybe to, like, their actual practices, but not really, right? So there were political, economic, and cultural religious kind of aspects to the anti-Judaism of this time. Now, I've already spoken for 33 minutes, so I'm going to try to do this quickly because this is really important to understanding our world today. Okay. Here goes tea. The problem. I've already mentioned this. Jesus was Jewish. His scriptures were Jewish. His early followers were Jewish. But Jesus was executed by the Romans in the 30s CE in cooperation with the Jewish priests of Jerusalem. Now, from a Jewish perspective, the Messiah that they were hoping for was not supposed to die. That was a real problem for Jews. This is why many Jews did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. So the movement that eventually formed that became successful around Jesus was mostly formed of ex-pagans. Okay. Now, this poses a challenge. How do you separate this new Christian movement from its Jewish roots? What Christian leaders ended up doing was promoting Christianity as a fulfillment or replacement of Judaism, right? They claimed that Christians were actually the true Israel. They're the only ones who have the right to use the word Israel. They claimed that Jews were too literal in the way that they read their own scriptures and in fact, misread their own scriptures. That's why they couldn't recognize that Jesus was a savior figure. But then, most interestingly, they claimed that If Jews didn't believe in Jesus, it's because they weren't meant to. It's because Jews were meant to be blind and stubborn so that Gentiles all over the world would have time to convert to Christianity before the end time. And when the Romans conquered Judea, destroying the temple in 70 CE, this was taken as confirmation of Christian claims, right, by Christians. Jews did not read it that way. Now, if we look at what was going on in the second century, we find like many competing Christian groups. And interestingly, we find all of these Christian groups accusing each other of being too Jewish. So Jewish, again, is used as a shorthand for just like not doing things right, not reading the scriptures correctly, or reading too literally. After 315 CE, right, when Constantine becomes emperor and legalizes Christianity, things actually get worse for Christians because they start excommunicating each other. So ironically, the longest period of imperially sponsored anti-Christian persecution begins with Constantine's patronage of the church. So as Ross Shepherd Kramer explains in this wonderful book, as soon as Constantine kind of authorizes and backs up the Catholic Church with the power of the empire, they start targeting Christian nonconformists, right? Like Manichaeans, Montanists, Ophidians, Priscillianists, etc. If you've never heard of these Christian books, so there are these Christian sects, right? It's because the Catholic Church was very successful in seizing their books, you know, and taking over their churches, exiling their leaders, and suppressing these dissident Christian movements. But after they attacked, right, all the dissident Christians, they went after the pagans, right, the pagan traditionalists. They prohibited traditional Roman religion and its practice, whether in public or private, on the pain of death or exile. And finally, after 418 CE, Catholic Church turns its efforts back to the Jews. So if you look at Byzantine law books, right, the law code of Theodosius or Justinian, you find prohibitions of Jews marrying non-Jews. You find Jews excluded from the civil service, from the military, from judicial practice. You find that Jews are prohibited from building new synagogues or renovating the synagogues they have. You find that Jews are prohibited from converting others to Judaism. Jews are prohibited from owning Christian slaves. Jewish leadership, right, which had developed after the destruction of the temple in Judea, the patriarchate, is abolished. Okay, so Christians target Jews, right? Even though, right, they had much in common earlier. And all of these laws are an expression of the way that the Christians deal with the Jews or think about the Jews. What the Catholic Church decides is that the Jews are to be preserved, albeit in a state of subjection, so as to testify to their own wickedness and to Christian truth until they finally accept Christ the second coming. Okay, so from kind of a traditional Christian perspective, Jews should be preserved, right? They're not going to be persecuted out of existence like those other sects were, because they, by their low status, by their subjection, they have to prove the truth of Christianity. And Christians maintain this hope that when, you know, Jesus Christ returns at the second coming, all Jews will convert. And by the way, the rest of them will be killed. So that's that. I just want to give like one like little example of anti-Judaism in action, as this example really struck me when I was reading this book. It became very common in antiquity during the Holy Week of Easter, which of course commemorates when Jesus was crucified. There was all this kind of whipped up anger kind of against the Jews at this time. So Holy Week of Easter became a time that Jews were often attacked by Christian communities. So there was a proposed law in 423 BCE that actually said that synagogues must not be seized indiscriminately nor set on fire, right? Clearly you don't need a law unless this is actually happening, right? Christians were setting synagogues on fire or kind of occupying them and consecrating them as churches really quick. And once you consecrate a synagogue as a church, right, it can't go back to being a synagogue. So there was a proposed law that Christians had to compensate Jews for the places that they seized or burned. However, as we can see from surviving Christian letters, these laws like never went into effect, or if they were kind of passed and legislated, they were never enforced. Because Christian monks like Ambrose or Simeon said that to enforce these laws, to provide restitution to Jews who had been wrong, that itself was an injustice. That was an injustice to the Catholic Church's dignity. So even when, like, sort of your imperial or secular powers try to intervene and offer Jews some modicum of justice, Christian leaders are, like, outraged, and these laws aren't enforced. So I'm basically out of time. So I just want to let you know that anti-Jewish rhetoric, kind of the patterns that I've shown you thus far, continue into Muslim contexts, right? Muslims also, you know, sometimes accuse each other of being Jewish when they don't think that they're reading their own scriptures correctly. Anti-Judaism continues through the medieval period. Jews are prohibited from most occupation except money lending. This is where you get kind of that stereotype of Jews as money lenders. I like to share this map with students. Every single circle represents a place where Jews were expelled between 1100 and 1800. So larger circles represent multiple expulsions. Interestingly, economists have correlated expulsions with times of drought. So whenever you need a scapegoat and things are going bad, Jews are very useful to expel. Finally, really quick gesture towards this example, 1390 week. Again, it's Holy Week in Spain. This time when Christians attack the Jews, this is not authorized by the Catholic Church, by the way, to give them the option of converting or being killed. Countless are killed. The rest do convert. So as Nirenberg points out in his book, for the first time, there's a land free of Jews. So does that spell the end of anti-Judaism? No. Because now everyone who converted from Judaism to Christianity is suspected of not being a true convert. And it's in this kind of the 14th and 15th century that we start seeing Jews discussed in more racial terms. Sometimes you talk about, you know, anti-Semitism in this context. So the disappearance of Jews does not spell the end of anti-Judaism. The ideology is too useful to disappear. So what are takeaways for us here in the 20th century today? I think that we have to learn to live with difficult questions. And when we study anti-Judaism, we have to look at who's in charge. What was the position of Jews in society? Who attacks? Who benefits? Right? How does prejudice translate into social or economic policy? Right? What happened to the Jews have much to do with who they were or the religion they practiced? Yeah, I don't think that there are any easy answers, because anti-Judaism is a powerful ideology, and often it's not so much about religious difference, but about Jews' status dissonance in society, the really kind of marginal space that Jews tend to occupy. Jews have often served as useful scapegoats, and the dehumanization and destruction of the Jewish population provided political, economic, and social benefits. Like, we have to be able to look at that and to acknowledge that it provided benefits, particularly in societies with deep inequalities. So be on the lookout for these kinds of questions and these factors in the weeks to come. We have lots of experts that we're going to hear from this term, and I hope that you'll join us and continue the conversation. So thank you for your attention, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Mika, and we'll take a short break until 5 o'clock, so about 7 minutes.
Okay, thanks for sticking around for question and answer. I said I would start with a question from students. And so the first kind of question I saw many of my students asking was, why is the most common manifestation of anti-Semitism today the idea that Jews compromise a secret cabal of elites who control the world's resources? And so my students are asking, like, why is this so common, even if its historical analysis shows that, right, Jews haven't really been in charge? So I think this is a really good and important question, because we can actually look at that example again from ancient Egypt and use that to answer this question. So already we see that the Alexandrians claimed that the emperor, right, had Jewish friends or Jewish senators that were controlling him. So why is that? What was useful about this argument, even though it had no basis in reality? So as Nuremberg points out in his book, what's useful about accusing the Jews of being secretly in charge is that it avoids accusing the Romans directly of being tyrants, right? It's a way for the Alexandrians to say bad things are happening because of secret Jews. It conceals the fact that the Alexandrians are suffering from Roman occupation, right? So it's like a very useful act of misdirection. It's good for the Alexandrians because they don't have to directly challenge Roman rule. It's good for the Romans because they don't have to take responsibility for anything going wrong. It's bad for the Jews, of course, because they're the minority and they're not actually in charge of doing anything. Now, why has this endured through multiple eras? So I would say it's a useful strategy, and we have to recognize that it's a strategy. It allows a group that feels like disempowered to avoid blaming the current socioeconomic order, right? It allows them to be angry without actually threatening those in charge and without threatening the actual elite. And usually the elite will let them get away with attacking, you know, the local Jews. So what do white supremacists in America, right, have to gain by blaming a secret Jewish cabal? They don't have to criticize the current American way of life for leaving them out, right? They don't have to criticize the richest and wealthiest people directly. And the elite find it useful, right? They don't have to take responsibility either. But I think even more than that, like, blaming secret Jews for stuff means that you don't have to even try to understand what's actually wrong with the world or with society or with, like, distribution of resources in America or with the way, you know, there's been, like, an ever lessening number of middle-class jobs. Like, wages have been stagnating for decades, even while CEO pay goes up. Like, you don't have to, like, understand all those complex issues and changes when you can just blame someone. You know, like, blaming someone, picking a target, blaming it is so much easier than learning about what got us into this, you know, economic crisis and what needs to change. So I think really digging into the reasons for inequalities threatens people who currently benefit from the economic order. So it's easier to just find a group and blame it. So I hope that helps. I hope that makes sense. Students do stick around later for our group discussion. Emily, do you want to pick the next question, or should I just go to the Q&A?
Yeah, I can definitely find some from the Zoom Q&A here. We had one specific question. You had mentioned different sects and sort of the Catholic Church being able to silence some, but why were they not able to silence the Jews in that same way?
Yeah, so actually it's a really interesting question, and that slide came out of Ross Shepherd Kramer's recent book. And I think actually what she shows really effectively, if the Catholic Church wanted to silence Jews, I 100% believe that they could have. The thing is, they didn't actually want to silence Jews. They didn't want to actually eliminate Jews, right? Because going back to one of Paul's letters, they believed that Jews had a role to play in the end time. And so they wanted Jews to be in a kind of oppressed position, but they didn't want Jews to actually, like, be, like, eliminated. Jews were always useful to have around so that kind of Catholics could define their own status against Jews. So I think it's very purposeful that so many of these Christian sects have disappeared, but Jews were allowed to remain disempowered. And I think, you know, what was really difficult about reading Roz Shepherd's book, What Christianity Costs the Jews, is that she does actually chronicle Jewish communities that disappeared, or Jews that were forced to convert, you know, and disappeared. So there were many places in Europe where Jewish communities did disappear. And I think it's important to acknowledge that.
Great, thanks. And then one more student question, or group of student questions. Yeah. How has anti-Judaism survived, or how has it survived in the current time, 21st century, in what locations?
Yeah.
Is it sort of still accepted and supported, and why? How does that work?
Yeah, so unfortunately, anti-Judaism or anti-Semitism, and I saw there's a question about the difference, I'll get to that in a second. Where is it still common? It's unfortunately still common around the world, even in places where Jews don't exist. And like, how is that possible? I think Nirenberg makes a very clear argument that it's ideologically useful, again, to blame Jews. Like anti-Judaism is a very useful ideology, even in places where there are no Jews. And that's a very depressing argument, but I think he amasses a lot of evidence for it, even in the United States. So I'm going to go to the Pew Research Center for some of their data. So they point out that, first of all, in the United States, Americans tend to express warm feeling towards Jews, with half of US adults rating them like 67 degrees or higher. They have this like thermometer, 0 to 100. So actually 67 is like the highest of all religious groups. So compared to other religious groups in America, like Americans actually think pretty well, I guess, of Jews. Although 10% have very cold feelings towards them. So maybe that's kind of gesturing at the problem, right? It doesn't take a very large group of haters to create a lot of noise and disruption. Another useful place to look at kind of hard data on this topic is the FBI releases crime statistics every year. And what the FBI shows is that 60% of hate crime victims in America are targeted because of their race or ethnicity, okay? Only 18.7% are targeted because of their religion. But if you look just at those targeted because of their religion, okay, of 1,600 victims of anti-religious hate crimes, this is from 2018, 56.9% were victims of crimes motivated by anti-Jewish bias. So within the category of anti-religious, you know, crime in America, Jews are like the top target. The next highest target are Muslims, and only 14.6% of anti-religious motivated crimes were Muslim. So unfortunately that suggests that, you know, anti-Judaism is alive and well in America. Now, regarding like the difference between anti-Judaism and anti-Semitism, I would say the consensus position in the United States is that anti-Judaism is specifically like hatred or dislike of Judaism as a religion, whereas anti-Semitism identifies Jews like racially as Jews. Now, what's interesting is Nirenberg in his anti-Judaism book asks, but is anti-Semitism really so different from anti-Judaism? Aren't the same tropes being used in the same exact way, just dressed up in like pseudoscientific racial language, right? And like race isn't real, right? It's a construct. Racism created the category of race. So his point was like, yeah, it's great. We're using like the pseudoscientific now to talk about the Jews, but it's just anti-Judaism. It's the same old anti-Judaism we've been seeing for centuries. And I have to say, I'm sort of persuaded by his account. So I know like people talk about, you know, anti-Semitism, but you know, I think the case in Spain really shows that even if you convert all Jews to Christianity, the anti-Judaism doesn't go away, you know, because like, it's just still such a powerful ideology. But, you know, Ana Gomez Bravo is gonna teach a class on this in the winter. We have several experts in this coming up later in the series. I hope you keep asking this question and we can find out what other experts think on this problem. Like, is there really a difference, or, you know, is it just, you know, a semantic squabble? I don't know.
Great, thank you. I think that's a good way to cover it and a great idea to keep circling back. as well. A little logistical note that someone asked if it's possible to share a reading list. I think one of my favorite things about this talk is all of the great sources that you were able to pull in and sort of book recommendations. So is there a reading list that could be?
Oh, yeah, I love compiling reading lists. I will share one. Maybe we can put we'll link to it on our website afterwards. We'll figure out a way.
Put it on the series page. That's a great idea. Mm-hmm.
Cool.
And looks like we still have more time. So if you don't mind getting into some sort of historical details, I don't know who better than you to answer these questions. Angie says, where was the imperial law 423 originally enacted? Was it during the fall of Rome or under Constantine? Which countries followed this law the most? So kind of when and where of that.
Yeah, okay. So fall of Rome, that's a very complicated question we can kind of set aside. Constantine, right, lived in the early 4th century. So I think he died by like 330 CE. So this is like long after Constantine's reign in the Byzantine period. And where was it enacted? Byzantine law is complicated. And Roz, this is also discussed in great detail in Roz Shepherd Kramer's book. The problem is, like, even though a law is published in the imperial court, which was in Constantinople, often laws seem to be in response to events that are happening somewhere else in the empire. So we can tell from other historical evidence that there was a case where Christians set a synagogue on fire in Italy. And there seems to have been another case of that happening in Syria. And in both cases, the local bishops, in one case it was Ambrose of Milan, the other case it was the Simeon, this very influential ascetic monk, they both kind of had the same reaction, like, how dare you hold Christians accountable for seizing synagogues when, you know, Jews reject Christ, they don't deserve the law, they don't deserve equality before the law. So what's interesting is that, right, like, this law sort of is published, but it's not copied and retained in later codices, which shows us that, like, it was never enforced, likely because of the outrage of these bishops. So it's in a really interesting case where we can see, like, someone's trying to do the right thing, right? Someone is trying to say, hey, Christians, you can't do this, but it just doesn't get enforced. And unfortunately, you know, I wish we had more evidence from the ancient world so we could speak to this in more detail, but we can just kind of make these inferences. Okay, so I see there's a question on the position of fundamentalist Christians.
Yes. What is the position of the fundamentalist Christians who support Israel, times, etc.? Aren't they actually anti-Semites? And I know this is a topic that Noam Pianko also researches. It's very interesting.
Yeah, you know, I actually gave a lecture on this for the Trump in the World series last spring. So I focused on Christian evangelicals who believe in the rapture. So I want to first of all say that this is not all Christians. This is a certain Christian interpretation that is popular. It was, you know, originally just, like I said, I mean, I guess the seeds of this are in the letter kind of Paul, right? Where he does seem to say that something is going to happen in the end time when Jesus returns. So the question is, like, how do you interpret what's going to happen with the Jews in the end times, right? And one of my teachers, John Gager, said, look, Paul didn't think there was any, like, Paul thought that the Jews would be in good relationship with God through the Torah, and that all these Gentiles kind of joining Jewish monotheism or joining the Jesus movement would gain the right relation with God through Jesus. Some Christians interpreted, you know, Paul's letters to say that actually Jews will all convert at the end times. And so, yeah, there is a significant number of Americans who believe that Jews need to believe in Jesus, or their role is to sort of die in the end times. And like a good number of, you know, American evangelical Christians really believe in this. And they believe that the foundation of the state of Israel is a sign of the end times, right? They don't see the foundation of the state of Israel as something that happens, you know, because of, you know, the Holocaust and the political, you know, forces in the 40s, right? And the United Nations declarations, they see the foundation of Israel as part of like a larger plan predicted by the Bible. It's really hard to deal with that, you know, as a Jewish studies scholar, you know, and because it's hard for me to like deal with like interpretations of the Bible that I don't agree with and that I don't think have a strong basis. And, you know, it was actually a professor at Harvard, Laura Nasrallah, that was like, she's like, all religion studies scholars, you have got to start talking about the rapture and end times because it's affecting our politics. And we have to acknowledge that there are these very fundamental, you know, differences in interpretation, and that, you know, like telling Jews that you think that they're going to go to hell or that they're going to die if they don't convert to Christianity, like it's dehumanizing. I don't know what to say. Like it's unacceptable. It's like offensive to me as like a human. I don't think you to be a good Christian, you don't have to believe that. You know, you could take up a different interpretation. That's on you. But it's true. Like we have to articulate these differences, and we have to talk about them. And yeah, that's one of the hardest ones to talk about. So thank you for making me talk about it. I hope that answers it clearly. Did I answer all parts of that question? So
I think that you did.
Yes. Okay.
I think we have time for one more question and then we'll sort of wrap it up. As a scholar of ancient history in the ancient world, what is it like from your perspective to lead a course on the Holocaust and to study 21st century Holocaust history? Because I think that's a really unique point of view and scholarship.
Yes, what a meta question. What is it like for me to be in this Holocaust class? I mean, I have been learning about the Holocaust my whole life, and I, you know, engaged with it very deeply while I was working on my master's. And, you know, I think the most difficult thing is that so many students come to Jewish studies through Holocaust studies. Like, I do think that the Holocaust forces us to confront what it is that makes us human and what it is that makes us inhuman, right? It's the biggest, most difficult questions. I can't say that, like, I'm not sure I have the resilience to face these questions all the time. The reason I study the ancient world is because I can have like some distance from like the most painful moments in history, you know? And when I choose to, I can like really engage with like, you know, what was it like for Jews in, you know, in 70 CE when they were confronted with like the catastrophe of their temple being destroyed and their, you know, independent kingdom being conquered by the Romans? And, you know, what was it like in 117 CE in Alexandria? And what was it like in 132 when Jews were like, well, it's been over 60 years, maybe God's really going to intervene in history this time. And they didn't. Like, I can engage with those questions, but there's not so much evidence that it's overwhelming. And so I think what's hard about Holocaust studies is there actually is so much. There's so much evidence, and there's so much evidence of suffering, and there's so much evidence of the way humans are awful to each other. And so it's not something I could do all the time, full time. But I do think it's like, it's a service to do it. I'm doing this for students and for the community, and because unfortunately it's taken the last 4 years to realize that if we don't confront the hard questions, they don't go away, right? Like current events are sort of they're forcing us to confront these parts of humanity, of history. So it's hard, but I'm glad I'm doing it in this wonderful community, and I'm looking forward to learning from all the other experts, you know? So I think every few years, we all have to go back for more Holocaust education because there's new amazing research and cutting edge insights. So thanks for that question. And if I didn't get to your question, write me an email. I'll do my best.